Morning. Welcome to Normandy Park United Church of Christ. Wherever you are on life's journey, you are most welcome here. This morning we have guest preacher, the Reverend Michael Ellick, and we welcome him here to this space. Reverend Ellick is currently the Director of Public Engagement for the Ecumenical Ministries of Oregon, but has served as a parish minister, a Buddhist monk, a community organizer, and a public finance analyst. Though best known in the public square for faith-based movement building work, primarily the New Sanctuary Movement and Occupy Wall Street, he is first and foremost a meditation teacher and a contemplative practitioner. Raised in the Old Growth Rainforest near the southern tip of the Salish Sea, Michael considers the forest his chief teacher and spiritual community. In recent years, he co-founded the Common Table of Oregon and Reckoning with Racism, interfaith organizing projects rooted in truth, repair, and reconciliation. So welcome. Let us now turn our attention to the land in which this church stands and the land of all the places where we live. We give recognition and honor to the Coast Salish peoples and the many tribes that call the Cascade Foothills home. We especially remember the Duwamish tribe that has asked us churches to pray with them in the month of April. May we remember their campaign to be recognized as a federal tribe, and may we be so compelled to pay real rent.
Good morning. I will read the light print. And please join me in the dark, the bold. Holy One, source of life, you are the one who walks with us when we are weary in our emptiness. You surprise us with your presence in your abundance. You reveal yourself to us and break bread with us. With a love that conquers death, you remind us we are yours, holy, 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 to the resurrected one who walks with us. Amen.
Let us pray. Meet us, O holy God, on the road to Emmaus. Guide us on the path, especially when we do not know where the path is leading us or where it is that we are going. Guide us in our vision for justice and for peace. Invite us in, O resurrected one, as we commission crop walkers this morning and break bread together. Invite us in, whether we are in the sanctuary or at home on Zoom. Invite us in to walk with you. Open our eyes so we might see the signs of your presence around us. Open our hearts so we may receive your peace and love. And empower us to pass on to others the grace you have shared with us so freely. Amen. So I would like to invite any crop walkers who are here this morning to come forward, and we might just have a couple. And if there's anybody on Zoom at home too, this is also for you. I'm gonna get my little walking foot here. We made these during the pandemic. Well, I didn't make them during the pandemic, but we made them during the pandemic. Someone, did you make these during the pandemic, Alice? Was it you? Lynn made them. Got to give credit where credit's due. So today in the Highline area, we're going to be walking for crop walk for hunger. And I think a lot of the proceeds this year are actually going to go for the war in Ukraine, but 25% eventually makes its way to the Des Moines Area Food Bank. And we walk because they walk. And so with this, I invite you all to please join in the bold print. We support and give thanks for all who are walking today in our Highland Area Crop Hunger Walk. You represent all of us as you walk to share our blessings with siblings in need around the world. We have been blessed. God has given to each of us many gifts, blessings, and talents, none earned and none deserved. That is why in faith we acknowledge that all that we have, all that we are, all that we shall ever be is a gift from God, a gift of which we are but stewards. We'll strive to be good stewards of the gifts we have received. When I can say, I have a home, we say, let us walk so that all may have safe shelter. When I can say, I have food, we say, let us walk so that none in our world will go hungry. When I can say, I have plenty to drink, we say, let us walk so that none shall thirst. When I can say, I have employment and a livelihood, we say, let us walk so that others might be able to provide for themselves and their families. When I can say, I have gone to school and now teach others, we say, let us walk so that schools might be available to children everywhere. We love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. So please pray with me. Holy Spirit, may your presence be felt to these walkers today, all of those who walk for us and walk for the world. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Please stand for the next hymn, which is sung to the tune of When Morning Gilds the Skies.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of reconciliation. God, who walks with us, forgive us when we have not loved ourselves, when we have not loved our neighbors, when we do not recognize you or your work in the world, when we have doubted your power to heal, forgive us, engage us, reshape our imaginations, trade our complacency for your courage, our pettiness for your possibility, our greed for your goodness, our aimlessness and for your adventure, our lives for your love. Words of assurance. Siblings in Christ, hear the good news. God has not abandoned us. God has not sent us out to find our own way. God is with us, all around us, at work within us. In the name of all that is, you are welcome into the grace, mercy, and forgiveness of the God who lives. Amen. Today's sacred story is from Luke 24, verses 13 through 30. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you are walking along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of these who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself and all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them."
Good morning. You hear me okay? Okay, thanks for the help, too. Greetings from Ainsworth United Church of Christ, where I'm a member back in Portland, Oregon, and of course from Ecumenical Ministries of Oregon, because everyone I work with would demand that I say so. So it's great to see you. Thank you for having me here this morning. And before we reflect together, let's pray. Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So today we start with the story of two spiritual seekers. We might even describe as spiritual, not religious. Both had fallen in with this teacher, prophet, revolutionary, and they had been following him around from place to place to place. They'd given up their regular lives. And it seemed like this radical movement was erupting into something entirely new. The whole world felt like it was turning over for these two, something new and exciting. But now their charismatic leader had died, and the heavy hand of the empire was falling down on all of them, and the followers of Jesus had begun to scatter. They started peeling off one by one, we can imagine, or in groups, going back to the lives they'd known before. The whole structure of their hope had been dependent on their teacher actually being alive and actually doing something that he did not end up doing. And now all their hopes were crushed and crashing right back down to the earth. But on the road to Emmaus, on the road leaving Jerusalem, after all the drama was over and all the cameras stopped rolling, they did have cameras back then. After all this, the world does turn over into something new for these two people. Jesus appears to them like something out of a dream. And we're told that their brains could not quite comprehend what they were seeing. He comes off like a fellow traveler on the road, just some person. a stranger. And when they ask, when he asks about them, they say, "We had hoped our teacher was the one who was going to redeem the country, but the authorities took him and they had him killed." It is so clear and easy to us reading this story 2,000 years after the fact that maybe his followers didn't really understand the full depths of what Jesus was doing. And I'm going to wager that maybe we ourselves also don't understand the full depths of what Jesus was doing. He used parables, not spreadsheets. He used miracles and performative actions to demonstrate something that he kept saying, "You don't quite get it." An entirely different dimension of reality, a different kind of relationship with God and with creation and with each other. But as soon as he was gone, of course, people freaked out. They lost whatever it was he was saying, and they go back to their old ways of thinking and doing things. They desperately wanted to hold on to that glimpse of a larger, more exciting world that they had been given. But before that vision could stabilize inside themselves and their fear and their doubt, they drifted back to what they'd known before. So when the two seekers said this to Jesus, thinking that he was still just some stranger on the road, at first Jesus sort of admonishes them. He basically says, "You don't get it." But he doesn't reveal himself to them yet because they can't see who it is for some reason. It's as if he's waiting for something else to happen. Like maybe there's a test or something, or maybe there's some thing about the Holy Spirit, which Jesus said would come, but maybe it didn't yet have an access point to flow through their bad ideas, and it was looking for some other route to bubble up between them. Because it isn't until later that day, just as the sun is starting to set, that the real turning of the wheel finally happens. As the two seekers finally come to the village of Emmaus, the stranger they'd been traveling with on the road just keeps walking. He's going to keep going into the night. And maybe we can imagine these two almost missed it. Maybe they hadn't passed yet some invisible test Jesus had for them, or the conditions weren't just right yet. But instead of letting him walk on alone in the dark, instead of just tuning him out as something that's not their problem, the two seekers beg the stranger to stay the night and share a meal with them. And this simple act of kindness and hospitality to a stranger in need opens up a portal for the Holy Spirit to blow through. A portal that no academic careful thinking could have ever opened, and no church liturgy could ever activate by itself. Through their act of kindness, Jesus is mysteriously revealed to them. So this all begs the question for us, where and how is Jesus revealed to us, the real Jesus? Where do we personally encounter in the real world the divine sacred logos, not just as an abstract idea that we read about and have a team that believes certain things about this idea, but something that is a living reality beyond our ideas? And if we don't have that experience, why don't we? Have we not passed some invisible test that Jesus has for us still? Are the causes and conditions somehow not quite right for us, or what is it? Because it was clear, even before Jesus died, that it was not enough to say his name, and it was not enough to meet him in the flesh. Plenty of people knew who he was and missed it all the time. And of course, that is all the more true for us who never met him at all. His name wasn't even Jesus. Spoiler alert. Well, of course, this is the third Sunday of Easter, This is a powerful story for us to consider. And as is this crop walk that some of you are about to go on, there is an auspicious connection for us here with the text. Because of course, feeding the hungry, advocating for the poor, these are the same kinds of spiritual practices that unlock that portal back in Emmaus. And as people of faith, our acts of kindness, our acts of hospitality also are not abstract moral obligations. If we are open to them, they are mystical acts of communion with God and neighbor. And this is how we remember Christ, not just in the Protestant sense of recollecting the things he said and trying to live them out in our lives, but also in the Eastern Orthodox sense, the monastic sense of mystically putting Jesus's body back together. In the Orthodox monastery, that's what remembering him means, putting his body back together in the world, and then waking up to the fact that we are all part of that larger body. Yesterday, I was remembered of this fun visceral lesson for me on this. And so once upon a time, after I finished seminary, I had this weird background. I studied for years under a Tibetan Buddhist lama. I'm the weirdo who was a Buddhist monk once upon a time, because this man that I had met, this Lama Pema, he exemplified the life of Jesus to me so much more than anything I had met in my own. And I came from a conservative Christian upbringing. And so I loved this guy. And I remember one time we're driving down the road together and we see this billboard sign, this Christian billboard sign. You've all seen signs like this. And it basically says, Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. And we all know what this means. There's sort of a code. It is not about religious diversity when someone puts that sign up on the road, right? It means something very specific. But my teacher, friend, Lama, doesn't know what this means or doesn't know what the code is, he sees it and he's like, wow, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. This is a very deep and profound. I had no idea Jesus said this. I will try to live this in my own life, and I hope they do as well. And it was a reminder to me how much the problem is never what Jesus says. It's the ideas we wrap around and then promulgate around Jesus. But my biggest lesson from my time with the Tibetans wasn't really from the lamas as much as it was from the refugees. If you don't know, back in 1959, when communist China invades Tibet, since that time, tens of thousands of Tibetans had to flee their country on foot to avoid persecution, and there was mass starvation and hunger as they found new places to be welcomed. And once upon a time, that was my work. I would help raise money and gather resources for Tibetan refugees in India, Bhutan, and Nepal. But this was, I'm a little kid from the suburbs outside of Olympia. This was the first time I had ever seen starvation, right? And we did not have money. We knew plenty of people who were poor and hungry by American standards, and I don't want to undervalue that in any way, but this was another scale of human suffering. We saw leper colonies. We saw whole families coming in out of the wilderness whose bodies had been twisted and misshapen. And I was horrified. I just wanted to look away from it. It was too much for my delicate little public school nervous system. And some part of me still wants to look away from it, even now after all these years. And it's very easy for me to look away because I have an entire culture and economy designed to help me do it. But back at the time, this is in Dharamsala in India, if any of you know India, this one kid in particular gets my attention, and he looks like a monster. His arms are shrunk. His face looks like a skull. And it's worse. By but I see him with these other kids, and they are hunched down in this little circle of monks and little children, and they're looking over some magazine, and I go up to see what they're looking at, and it's an advertisement for a huffy dirt bike. Your kid, someone has a huffy dirt bike. And this was the exact kind of dirt bike I most wanted when I was their age, once upon a time. And it probably sounds privileged and totally ridiculous, but this little bridge of understanding and empathy was built, a synapse across the vast chasm of our experience in that moment. And it doesn't sound like much to repeat it to you out loud, because it's not an intellectual thing, it's an emotional thing. It's a metabolic body thing, but I saw myself in him, and I saw him in me, and through this, I saw some deeper communion that we are always a part of. And this insight did not feed that boy. It did not dissemble the social inequity of our respective roles in any way. But I caught a glimpse of this vast chain of being that we are all a part of, this branches and vines that connect us. And in my mind at that moment, that is the divine logos. And I've come to believe if your body sees it, you get better a little. Not as an abstract idea that we repeat. I'm paid to repeat abstract ideas, by the way. That's what they trained me to do. But as a living reality that you've got to encounter for yourself. And this illuminates something for us as Christians reading about the story of Jesus. Because our gospel tradition, it literally claims not only that Jesus came back from the dead 3 days after he died, but that when he did come back, he could apparently look like different things to different people. In some versions, Mary Magdalene mistakes him for a gardener or an angel outside the tomb. And later, two of his students mistake him for a stranger on the road for what, the better part of a day? They didn't look from a different angle. God, you look like somebody. And although the text falls short of literally claiming that Jesus came back as a shapeshifter, although it's implied, it's as if Jesus dies and then comes back as everybody, so that everybody might be the Christ. Everybody is now part of the divine logos, and everyone we meet, including ourselves, might be God's infinite care made incarnate, just as Jesus says over and over again that we are, especially back in Matthew 25 when he says, whatever you do for the least of these, you are literally, in the Greek, doing to me. Wow. Through this possibility, the gospel invites us directly into the living heart of the world through every concrete act of kindness and hospitality. The story asks us to consider not only the possibility that the inherent compassion of being interconnected, all of us, is the dominant reality of our universe. And that in comparison, things like time, space, history, identity are all convenient cover stories whose only true value is to express our deeper communion. The Bible asks us to consider not only that God is real, but that God is here. Right now, in this room, with all of us, not in the olden days, and that all of us, taking the form of God with each other in community, this is the communion that Jesus is always pointing to, and that's something we can discover for ourselves whenever we make peace and break bread with all the different parts of God's body still being put back together. And I am not asking you to take my word on that, or the Bible's, because the Bible says this very, very clearly, especially if you don't read it in English. But I do invite you all to find out for yourself firsthand in the context of your own life and relationships, if that might be true, because everything changes if it does. Amen.
Siblings in Christ, as scripture this morning, Jesus, the risen one, gathered with his disciples and broke bread with them. It was a resurrection meal, just days after the Last Supper in the upper room. And if we read on in scripture, we read that their eyes were opened and their hearts were on fire as they recognized their friend in the breaking of that bread. It's true. The resurrected Jesus still loved to share a meal with his friends. Maybe that was the secret test. This morning here in the sanctuary, we celebrate with crackers and with grapes. We're in that middling place of the pandemical times. We're just going to continue with grapes for a little while. This table here is an expansive table. There is food for everyone. There is a place for everyone. There is love for everyone. There is no scarcity here because this is God's table, and so all are welcome. Everything is gluten-free and allergy-friendly. And wherever you have journeyed from this morning and from wherever you have landed at home on Zoom, you are welcome here. So let us pray. God of resurrection, God who walks the path of life with us, God of the here and now, where do we begin? Our hearts can be full of so many things: gratitude, hope, fear, doubt, dreams, belief. As a result, our prayers can often feel chaotic at best, bouncing around to each name and need that comes to mind. So settle us, summon us, and call us into our own becoming. As we prepare for communion this morning, remind us of the things that draw us closer to the expansive life you dream for us. Remind us of meaningful friendships, where we find health and wellness of mind and body and spirit, how the thrum of justice can set our hearts on fire, and how your word is to be lived out in our bodies, in our daily lives. Help us. Guide the way. Meet us on the road. Walk with us for a while. Dine with us. Break bread for us. Gather us up into your expansive love until that promised day when swords are beaten into plowshares and the prayers of the people are only prayers of joy. We ask that you pour out your spirit onto this bread and onto this cup and onto these grapes so that we might catch a glimpse of you here at this table. Until that promised day, we will continue to pray, and especially pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So during that resurrection meal, Jesus took the bread and he broke it and he gave thanks. And it seems like he began to give the bread to them when he disappeared from their sight. The eyes of the disciples were opened and their hearts were on fire. They remembered. And they knew that their rabbi, the risen one, was there in the sharing of the holy meal. So let us remember how Jesus took the bread and blessed it and broke it for his friends, saying, "Each time that you eat of this, do so in remembrance of me." And as the story goes from the upper room, Jesus took that cup and he blessed it and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you. And as often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." So, siblings in Christ, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. I invite you, when you are ready, to come forward for your cup of cracker and grape. And we will sing also while we do communion. For his apt message this morning. We're so blessed to have guest preacher one. In this time of prayer, we lift up those who are on our prayer list and those whose prayers have not yet been uttered aloud. We lift up all of these folks that we have talked about and shared about and the joys that we have shared this morning. We pray with those who are healing from surgery, those who are surviving cancer, those who are homebound, and those who are celebrating joys, big and small, reducing medication, getting accepted into colleges, all of these things we celebrate. We pray this morning for all the many ways our world is fractured and scattered. Help us to name our fears. We fear the lengthening onslaught in Ukraine. We fear for our neighbors at the southern border, La Frontera, who are being harassed and othered. We fear for our good earth and potential wildfire season. There are so many reasons to worry. Hold all of this with us and help us to release our fears to you. And God, I pray this morning for our conference, the Pacific Northwest Conference of the United Church of Christ. The stewards of the budget have been asked to go back to the drawing board and to create a budget that reflects the justice work you have called us into as church together. Be with those who are exhausted from fighting the fight for anti-racism. Be with those who are unsettled and disgruntled for having their assumptions challenged. Be with our conference ministers as they shepherd a flock that seeks hope and is also discouraged. Be with all of us as we discern the next right steps in love. Be with those who are worshiping together right now as a conference with Westminster United Church of Christ in Spokane. Help us to keep listening. Help us to keep learning. O God, who walks the road with us, hear our prayers this day and every day, and a special shout out to all of our walkers for Crop Walk. Amen. Annual meeting that Vicki and Shannon and I attended on Zoom yesterday for the Pacific Northwest Conference of the United Church of Christ, we did not pass the budget, and we did not elect committee members for the next slate for the next term. I serve on the Committee on Ministry, and so, you know, things are kind of up in the air. So I just really do ask for prayers. It's a challenging time because we are a denomination of firsts, right? We always talk about all these great things that we do, and yet we have voices in our conference are saying, do more, do better, and do it now, because too much time has passed, too much lip service has been given, and we have not done it yet. So there we are. So that is one of my announcements this morning. The other one is kind of fun. We're having a fundraiser for our Blue Theology trip with our youth, and there's going to be a plant sale this next Saturday. And so if you've got plant starts or things that you would like to bring to the plant sale that our kids can sell to raise money for the Blue Theology trip, that would be wonderful. We're also going to be raffling off a Zenith Holland Gardens gift certificate. So that's an extra reason to come and see if you might be the lucky person to take that home with you. So anyways, come for our youth next Saturday between 10 and 2 p.m. Are there any other announcements? Lynn?
I just want to remind everyone that this next Friday is Bible and Brews again, and I'll be sending out the psalm, maybe, from the reading that comes from the book we're using. It's always fun to be there with Shannon and Amy and learning and talking and discussing. So if you haven't been, come and join us 7 o'clock on Friday on Zoom. And for the plant sale, some of you know I built a greenhouse last summer. So I've been growing seeds, and I've got flowers and vegetables and zucchini and pumpkins and artichokes starts that will be at the plant sale on Saturday. So, and I'm looking forward to trying to get that raffle ticket, because I love that Zenith Holland or Des Moines Zenith, whatever it's called. They got wonderful stuff there. So hopefully you come.
And Lynn, is it true, will you be here at church afterwards if there's people at home on Zoom that want to do some giving for Crop Walk? Is that true?
Yes. If you haven't had a chance to give us or to donate to the Crop Walk, Alice and I will both be here afterwards, so you can drop on by, and we'll gladly take your check written to Church World Service /crop. And I think we've gotten a little bit more. I'm not sure what the total is now. Alice might know, but. Oh, yeah, the So meet at the Des Moines Methodist Church on the back patio. It's on the north side of the church at 1:20. Our time is 1:20. We're going off in 10-minute intervals. So at 1:20, we're going to be walking our normal walk around Des Moines. So it'll be nice to get out and be with some, well, sort of with other people staggered around. So if you can make it, come on down. If you didn't, you know, if you don't have any donations, that's okay. You know, walkers are good.
Thanks, Lynn. Well, with that, we're so grateful for all the ways that you are so generous in this congregation. I can't say it enough. We have gotten through this pandemic together and surviving and thriving and as a vital church, and all the ways that you give and continue to give, your time, your talent, your treasure, it is so very appreciative. We're just very blessed as a congregation. So thank you, thank you, thank you.
Peace that passes all understanding, already living inside your heart. Our service now concludes, and as we go outside and walk to wherever it is we're going, our real service now begins. Amen. Let's sing. Amen.